All right, good, good. I think there'll even be a better time tonight with no doubt here, right? Good. All right, so let's get started. I'd like to start this morning where the video left off, with a simple question. How do we think? Every day, every minute, our brains process incredible amounts of information and go through multiple stages of analysis. Most of the time, it happens without us even realizing that we're doing it. First, we observe our surroundings. We interpret what we see. We evaluate those observations based on our experience and perhaps our bias, and then we make decisions. This is the human cognitive framework. We do this seamlessly. We learn from our mistakes, we learn from our experiences, and over time, this enables us to deliver expertise, to develop and become experts. We can all relate to this. Each of us in this room are experts in our own fields, and we've all worked hard to become professionals. However, we're only human, and there are limits to what we can do. As professionals, we need help. Take these professioners, a lawyer, an HR leader, and a chef. They are being overrun by information. The myriad of professional research publications, the unrelenting flood of social media, and the explosion of data from the digitization of the physical world, or the so-called Internet of Things. To make sense of this, we need analytic capabilities that help us turn big data into information, and then turn that information into knowledge. For example, let's start with the profession of law. This lawyer is an expert. She was the president of the Stanford Law Review, and just this year got promoted to chief legal counsel for a Fortune 100 corporation. She's vetting a multi-billion dollar acquisition and is questioning what resources are required to successfully navigate the regulatory hurdles. Her decision is whether outside expertise schooled in corporate inversions is required to be brought on the project. Let's take a look on the other end of the spectrum, the creative side. This chef is an expert. She studied at the Cordon Bleu. She owns an acclaimed restaurant with two Michelin stars. Every night, dozens of demanding customers enter her doors and expect perfection. In order to deliver the best experience to her customers, she's constantly making decisions. She tries to keep up with the latest culinary trends, but the task has become overwhelming. Does this sound familiar? The context of their challenges could not be more different, but the way they approach decision-making is remarkably similar. The quality of the decisions of all of these professionals is driven by their expertise, with each profession having its own unique language and body of knowledge. And like all of us, these professionals have strongly held views that may or may not be optimal for the decisions at hand. For example, our HR professional has the belief that a potential candidate's history of job hopping is a red flag. Maybe that's true most of the time. But what about when it's not? What's more, as professionals, we're subject to significant external influences. Take, for example, the brutal competition in the restaurant industry and the fear of a bad review in an influential newspaper, or the challenge of navigating a complex and evolving regulatory environment. What's the consistent pattern here? It's the distinct language and terminology of each profession, the heuristics we apply to decision-making, and the ever-growing sources of information that we're expected to draw upon. The question is, how do we help professionals achieve better outcomes? Imagine a tool, an advisor, a mentor, a coach, or concierge that can help us see the world and its possibilities in new ways. Imagine if you could strip out and eliminate the bias that we all have deeply ingrained within our own cognitive frameworks and make decisions that take into account the facts, research, and insights of others. Cognitive computing can help us do that. It can help us enhance, scale, and accelerate human expertise. The Nobel Prize-winning psychologist Daniel Kahneman says, expertise is acquired through prolonged experience with good and appropriate feedback on our mistakes. This expertise is what forms the basis of our professional decisions. It's what enables us to make decisions with confidence. Take chess. The grandmaster sees and acts on patterns that are invisible to most of us as they evaluate each move. Doctors evaluate patient symptoms against known data to make life or death decisions one after another for hours at a time. Both of these professions benefit from an environment of near continuous feedback, enabling them to make the types of decisions we associate with experts. But often, human expertise comes up short. Sometimes we make errors in calculation or in our reasoning, or perhaps we misinterpret cues from the environment. Take astrology, for instance. For millennia, the human mind has seen causal patterns where there really aren't any. Sometimes our experience isn't quite as broad as we think it is. We can become overconfident and then make costly mistakes. The good news? Cognitive systems like IBM Watson can help us bridge gaps in our knowledge, mitigate bias, help us generate better insights while discerning new patterns, allowing us to make even better decisions. Even more important, Watson can help us democratize expertise, acquiring knowledge and intuition once limited to a select few by learning the best practices of experts and scaling them to the masses. So what makes Watson cognitive? First, Watson understands and operates in natural language. We interact with Watson just as if we were having a conversation with another human being. And Watson understands what we're asking for in the complete context of our question. Watson makes evidence-based recommendations with clear levels of confidence using advanced analytic and machine learning. In a sense, using its own cognitive framework. No guesswork, just the unbiased, unvarnished facts, an approach that closely resembles the reality of how we make complex decisions every day. Seldom do we encounter a problem or a challenge that can be solved by a single right answer. For example, doctors will evaluate a range of possible hypotheses or treatment alternatives before selecting what they think is the best one. And financial planners will weigh many different investment options before they make a recommendation to you. Watson's not bound by volume, memory, or format. It can read millions of unstructured documents in seconds. In fact, one instance of Watson Discovery Advisor has read over 60 million documents, with 30,000 new documents being added every single day. I don't know about you, but I don't read that fast, and I can't remember that much. At another client, Baylor University, Watson's reducing the time it takes to discover new cancer-fighting phosphates from years to a matter of days, leveraging the 23 million documents in PubMed's Medline. Watson's been learning the language of professions and has been trained by experts to go to work in a number of important industries. The promise for all of us in this is the democratization of information, and with it, innovation, putting discovery and exploration in the hands of anyone who cares to use it.
Watson here, what are we working on today?
Watson and I are here today to announce a new portfolio of Watson applications. This is a quickly growing collection of Watson apps designed for specific use cases. Think specific industries, specific users, with specific content. The first applications in the portfolio are IBM Watson for oncology, to help doctors choose the right cancer treatments for their patients. IBM Watson for wealth management, to help wealth advisors give personalized financial advice to their clients. And one you may already be familiar with, Chef Watson, to spur inspiration and innovation in the culinary arts. Watson apps have three main ingredients. First, the content is tailored to the use case and is available with the application. For example, Watson for Wealth Management ingests knowledge from the annual reports of companies and their SEC filings, along with real-time content from providers like the Associated Press and Morningstar. Second, the app has one or more Watson and IBM technologies or APIs integrated into it. And third, it's all pre-integrated around a specific use case for a specific industry for a specific set of users. Looking ahead, you can expect to see many more additions to this portfolio, targeting a variety of industries and professions: legal, healthcare, research, education, finance, and many more, coming from both IBM and its partners. For example, in healthcare, let's take the role of physician. Watson has the capability not to learn just the science of medicine, but also the art of medicine, the best practices. Cognitive computing can actually start to pull together a massive sea of information and make it work better. We've been working with world-class organizations like MD Anderson, the Cleveland Clinic, the Mayo Clinic, and the New York Genome Center. One example is the work we've been doing in partnership with the doctors at Memorial Sloan Kettering Cancer Center around Watson for Oncology. Let's hear from Dr. Mark Criss about the challenges doctors and oncologists are facing.
Doctors, they're always second-guessing themselves. Have we done enough? Have we learned everything we could about the condition, about the patient? We've been faced with an extraordinary explosion in medical knowledge. It's reassuring that there's some way to focus it. IBM Watson can help doctors make the best treatment decision. I know that's counterintuitive. Machine actually personalizes care more.
IBM Watson for Oncology solution, trained by the physicians at Memorial Sloan Kettering, beginning this January, will be used by the doctors at Bumrungrad International Hospital in Thailand to treat their base of more than 1 million patients spanning across 100 countries across Asia and Africa. Let's take a quick look at how the solution works. Mark, can you show us?
Absolutely. Thank you, Mike. So, healthcare is actually a perfect domain for Watson technology. There's an explosion of structured and unstructured data. Doctors cannot keep up with the changes in treatment guidelines, clinical trials, all the information that's coming in. There's journals, all this information, and they're being challenged to work more efficiently. So that is actually a perfect situation for Watson Oncology.
You got to use your hands.
Really?
Yeah. Unless you want me to do the demo.
Did my mic not work?
Your mic is not working.
Okay.
All right, keep going.
Don't blame me for that one.
All right.
Okay. So I'm going to show you a little bit about Watson Oncology. This is actually a working live system. As Mike alluded to, we have partnered with Memorial Sloan Kettering on this solution. So you're really taking the power of Watson and cognitive, and you're combining it with all of the training, the thousands of historical cases that Watson has read in from Memorial Sloan Kettering. And think about the power of this. You have certain centers out there where an oncologist has to see every type of cancer. And they might see in a given day, they might see a breast cancer patient, colorectal cancer patient, but at Memorial Sloan Kettering, they have specialists. A person might see nothing but small cell lung cancer all day, and that means that we're able to take that best practice, number one, according to U.S. News and World Report, cancer center in the country, Memorial Sloan Kettering, and you'll see now how that comes together in Watson Oncology. So We've brought up a patient case from the Watson patient list. This is a 67-year-old female with stage 2 breast cancer. And the first thing that Watson has done is, you can see here, it is summarized from all of the notes, all of, you know, they may have been recommended and sent over to your cancer center. They may have been, they have all of their information, they have all of their records, they have unstructured notes. All of this now has been summarized, and the oncologist can go through and see only the pertinent information that pertains to this patient's breast cancer. And you can see all of these factors here. If you want to look and see where was this extracted, you can see that Watson is extracted from unstructured notes, physician notes, all of this information, and brought it together. And now the clinician is seeing, it sees this little badge here with the number 1, and it says you have to go and verify that you agree with all this information that has been extracted. So they agree, and now Watson goes, and that fast, it's read all of the information, it has applied treatment guidelines, it's applied all of the best knowledge of Memorial Sloan Kettering, and it has presented these treatment plans. And not only has it taken these individual cancer recommendations, it's ranked them, it's scored them, it's pulled in all of the supporting evidence, it's brought it all in one place. You can imagine them walking through the halls. This would all be running on an iPad. They're walking from one patient to the next. They're able to see a representation of the best treatment for this patient. And not only are we showing the treatment plan and the timeline for all of the treatments, but for each individual treatment, we've ranked them and scored them, and we have all of the supporting information for each of these treatments. So think how much efficiency and how important this is. All of this information, it's like being able to, at any cancer center in the United States or in the world, it's like being almost able to pick up the phone and call Dr. Chris at Memorial Sloan Kettering, your expert colleague, your learned colleague in lung cancer, and say, Dr. Chris, what would you do with this patient given all their characteristics? And now that's all brought into Watson. It's showing you all of the literature that's been considered. It has the full corpus. We've ingested over 1 million journals. All that information is all brought in. We're going to be able to do eligibility criteria for clinical trials to show not only are there standard of care treatment options, but a set of clinical trials that this patient is eligible for, which is a huge problem in healthcare, because there are these long eligibility criteria, there's all this information that Watson has, and it can now blend that information together and show you, here are clinical trials that this patient is eligible for. We pull in all of this drug information, showing you contraindications and side effects, everything you need to know about this. We can show you where that information was extracted, bring that together, and show whether this matches your patient. And when you are comfortable, see, ultimately, the clinician still has the final judgment. And when you are comfortable with that, you're now picking your treatment, and you can identify which of these choices, and you can build a customized handout exactly for this patient, instead of just giving them one glossy brochure that just says lung cancer or breast cancer that's the same for every single patient. Here we have all of this information with exactly their attributes, the literature that patient should read, patient education materials for them to take home and read. So it's really the full gamut of all the technology, cognitive, Watson technology, the expertise of Memorial Sloan Kettering, all brought together to improve cancer care.
Thank you, Mark. Pretty cool, huh?
Yeah.
We've recently extended Watson beyond just the cancer capabilities of Jeopardy fame to discovery and innovation. With Watson Discovery Advisor, we're working with a number of pioneering organizations who are using Watson to fast-track life-saving research, create connections in cold criminal cases, spark creativity in the culinary arts, and uncover new insights at an unparalleled pace. Seconds, not days, weeks, not decades. We're working with organizations such as Baylor University, Johnson & Johnson, and Santa Fe, and new industries like culinary sciences, and law enforcement with organizations like the Tucson Police Department.
Introducing the IBM Watson Discovery Advisor.
pinpointing facts and analyzing information from tens of millions of books, online articles, and other unstructured data sources that no one person could understand in 100 lifetimes, unveiling the hidden connections, leading you down new lines of thinking, interacting and communicating the way you do, understanding context, wordplay, and even puns while learning the language of your industry or profession. A powerful computing solution that gives experts the confidence to make new connections, then crack the code on advancements that were previously unthinkable. Watson is forging new partnerships between humans and computers to enhance, scale, and accelerate human expertise. It's a new dawn of discovery, and Watson is the spark. What will you discover with Watson?
Let's dig a little deeper into these discovery capabilities and take a look at how Watson is going to work fighting crime. Anne, why don't you show us?
Thank you, Mike. So, good morning. What I'm going to be showing you today is how an investigator interacts with Watson to help uncover connections, patterns, and non-obvious relationships in data. And the challenges that analysts have is they need to work with large volumes of data from disparate data sources and of varying types of data. And they need to quickly derive insight from that data. And what's happening is that 80% of the analyst's time is spent on collecting data, sifting through the data, managing the data, and only 20% of the time actually analyzing the data, which is what they were hired to do. So by leveraging Watson's cognitive technologies with i2's visualization and analytic capabilities, we're hoping that we can flip that statistic around. So let me start the demonstration. Many of you may be familiar with AMC's Breaking Bad show. If you are, you'll recognize the character's name in the demonstration. If you're not, this is a law enforcement scenario where we put ourselves in the role of an investigator, Agent Schrader, and we try to find out more information about a new drug on the street called blue meth and the people that are associated with that drug. So let me go ahead and start. And the first thing we would do as investigators is we'd look into our own agency's or organization's repository. This is a database, structured database, to see what information we have in there that other analysts have put in about blue meth. And so I'm going to show you here the information that we have. And you can see here, and what's important is the people that are associated with blue meth. So we see there's blue meth. We see here's Jesse Pinkman, right, was arrested for being in possession of blue meth. So we know there's a very strong connection there between Jesse Pinkman and blue meth. What we don't know much about is this other guy named Heisenberg. We do know that it's a street name. We don't know his real name, so you see there's a question mark there. But we do know that he's presumed the manufacturer of this meth. And so that's the person we're interested in finding out more about. But you can see when I click on it, there's not much information in the database. So as investigators, essentially we've hit a dead end. So we have some options. We can send our agents back out on the street, but very time consuming for them to try to find out more information about Heisenberg. We can sort through some of the data that we have, the papers, the reports, notes, interviews, but again, time consuming. Or we can interact with Watson. So let's interact with Watson. What we're doing here is we're actually searching unstructured, open source, publicly available data. And we're going to ask Watson, this is a live demonstration that I'm showing you, and we're going to ask Watson what Watson knows about Heisenberg. So I want you to watch when I hit return how quickly Watson can process information. Okay, just hit return. See how quickly that came back? In less than a second. And what you're seeing on the left here, these are possible answers from Watson. And why is it important to get more than one answer? Because for analysts, investigators, even researchers, that, you know, it's not about proving or disproving one hypothesis. It's about generating new hypotheses, generating new leads, maybe going down a different line of inquiry. So let's look at what Watson has identified. You see, for example, physicists here. And if I click on physicist, I can see the supporting evidence. Why did Watson surface physicist as a possible answer? Well, some of you may know Heisenberg is, in real life, was a physicist associated with the uncertainty principle. And what Watson does is it looks at the question that I typed in. It saw I typed in who, so it knows I'm looking for a person. Typed in Heisenberg, but I also typed in alternate name, right, alias. So Watson knows that. It did extract physicist, bringing it to our attention, but look at the confidence level it gave it. Very low confidence level, but important for us to know. So now let's go back and let's look at the top ranking answer, which is Walter White. And let me show you what else we've done very quickly is we've done entity extraction. So people, places, locations, events, and how they're related. And let's go ahead and visualize that, much easier to visualize. And what you can see here is the information that we pulled out about Walter White from the publicly available data. And you can see here, we can see he was spotted at a lab. You can see he has lung cancer, right? He was at a school. And what I'm gonna do, we're still trying to get the connection, remember, back to Jesse Pinkman. So what we're gonna do is we're gonna go ahead and click on Jesse Pinkman, and they're gonna expand in the same fashion to see what else we can find about Jesse Pinkman, because we're trying to make that connection between someone who we know is in possession of blue meth and someone who we think may be Heisenberg. And what you're seeing on your screen here, do you see we have many, many connections that link Jesse Pinkman to Walter White? Enough connections that as investigators, we may be able to go to a judge and ask him or her to issue us a search warrant. So what have we seen? We've seen the ability for the analysts to accelerate discovery and understanding of relevant evidence from large data sets. We've seen how we've combined structured and unstructured data and how we can quickly visualize entities and relationships.
Thanks,
Thank you.
Anne. You've just seen how Watson can discover patterns and unlock insights. Watson can also help us unlock our own creativity. And we've been exploring this in the domain of cooking with our partners at the Institute of Culinary Education and with Bon Appetit.
My first reaction upon learning about the Chef Watson system, a little bit of skepticism, I think, but also a real eagerness to kind of jump in, because I do like this analytical approach to creativity. And I also just love the possibilities. Just the mere mention of it, my head kind of went off in a different direction thinking of all the possible applications. I'm a pastry chef by training, and working with a system like Chef Watson organizes creativity in a way that my pastry chef's mind likes to organize things and regiment things and measure things. And what it does is, it more than anything, it gives you access to a seemingly infinite amount of data that we could not possess as mere mortal humans.
Steve, let's take a look at how Chef Watson actually works.
Absolutely. Thanks, Mike. You know, I love watching Michael and James from the Institute of Culinary Education talk about how Chef Watson has enhanced their creativity. But what I'm about to show you is a version of Chef Watson that's been designed for the home cook. You see, food and cooking is such an essential part of our everyday lives. It's not just about sustenance and nutrition. Food is a central part of our social and cultural fabric. But whether you're a professional cook, an enthusiastic home cook, or a parent just trying to get dinner on the table between soccer practice and homework, it can be hard to find the creative inspiration to come up with something new and interesting. Chef Watson lets you discover brand new recipes that have never been seen before that can meet your needs. To do this, Watson has ingested over 9,000 kitchen-tested recipes from Bon Appetit, and from that, it's learned about ingredients, which ingredients have often been used together, and which ingredients are common to most culinary styles. And it's also learned what's needed to make a given dish, like what ingredients do you need to bring together to make soup, and how is that different from what you'd need to make a burrito. It's also learned about food chemistry, and it can apply something called hedonic psychophysics, which is the psychology of what people find pleasant and unpleasant. It uses all of this knowledge to come up with ingredient combinations that it thinks will both surprise and delight. Let's see how this works. So imagine I'm having some friends over for brunch, and I'd like to cook something with an ingredient that might be seasonal and local. I just saw some beautiful leeks at the farmer's market, and I'd like to use those. So I'll type in leeks over here as an input ingredient that I want to use. Turns out my daughter is allergic to apples, so I want to make sure that we avoid apples. Use that as an ingredient to avoid. And believe it or not, I have a friend coming over who does not like bacon.
How does anybody not like bacon?
It's complicated. So let's make sure we make something that has neither apples nor bacon in it. Next thing is, Chef Watson is going to present me with some possible dishes that I can make. These are things that it has learned might be useful to make with leeks. And there's a nice list here that comes from the Bon Appetit database. Since we're talking about brunch, let me see if I can do something like a frittata, perhaps. Next, Chef Watson presents me with a list of styles of cuisines that I might use for my leek frittata. These can be anything from a regional cuisine or a style of cooking that's appropriate for a given event or an occasion. I'm thinking about something a little bit spicy, so I'm gonna choose Cajun Creole cuisine. And when you think about a dish, there are a huge number of possible ingredients that could be brought together, billions, maybe even quintillions of ingredient combinations. Watson very quickly narrows down that space and it generates thousands of possible combinations that it thinks will work well, and it sorts them, and it instantly presents the user with 100 options. For each option, it gives you not only the ingredients, but it makes suggestions for how much of each ingredient to use. And based on the Bon Appetit recipe it finds that's closest to the ingredient list it came up with, it derives and generates instructions for how to go ahead and prepare that dish. You can browse through all the available dishes that it's come up with. The ones over here on the left are the ones that it thinks are most classic. These would be most similar to things that it's already found in its database. The ones over here all the way on the right are much more unique ingredient combinations. These are things that it thinks would be much more surprising. So you can see here's a leek that has, a frittata that has spinach, watercress, turnip greens, as well as two cheeses, goat cheese and camembert. Here's one with juniper berries. That sounds like an interesting idea for a frittata. And these decisions that it makes about what to present are based not only on what it's read before about what has gone well together, but again, also what it knows about that underlying food chemistry. So it knows about the flavor compounds that are in each ingredient and how well that makes them go together. This app is currently in beta. We currently have thousands of people that are taking it through its paces. They're helping us to refine it. And of course, they're all creating delicious recipes that Watson helped them discover. You too can experience this by signing up for our beta at bonappetit.com/chefwatson. And we've also compiled the best and most interesting of these recipes into a cookbook that we've called Cognitive Cooking with Chef Watson, which will be available later this year. It's actually a beautiful cookbook. Anyway, as I said, this version of Chef Watson is really designed for the avid home cook, but we're also working with our clients in the food and flavor industries. That means retail grocery, consumer products, restaurants, and even appliance manufacturers. And we're working with them to find ways of using this application of Watson to transform their businesses.
Thanks. Thanks, Dave. I don't know about you, but I wouldn't have expected IBM to come out with a cookbook this year, right? It was an interesting turn along the way. But you've just seen three very different examples of Watson apps, and this is just the beginning. Entrepreneurs and established enterprises will bring the creativity and innovation to drive entirely new applications. In fact, that's the work of our quickly growing ecosystem. A network of partners who are building cognitive-based businesses. We've had over 3,000 companies approach us to become part of the ecosystem across 26 industries, 75 countries, all looking to join in. We've grown from three initial developer partners on the platform in January to over 100 active application developments going on today on the platform. I'm personally in awe of the scope and scale of the work they're pursuing. From helping veterinarians improve a higher quality of animal care to personalized health care. From retailers establishing better connections with clients to reinventing the way we travel. It's been incredible to see the diversity of solutions across industries, across geographies, and different use cases. The first wave of powered by IBM Watson apps are hitting the market today, and let's hear about a few of them.
GenieMD is the product that we have developed with Watson, and it empowers individuals to take a more active role in managing their own health and the health of their loved ones.
We're using Watson to bring the power of big data to the shop floor with simple, digestible information by taking the product's data as well as unstructured data like blog posts, FAQs, social feeds, and delivering relevant results quickly while still engaging directly with the customer.
Sophie is an application powered by IBM's Watson that allows veterinarians to interact with information much like they would a colleague. We're cramming his 110-doctor practice into each and every exam room, and then powering that with the collective intelligence of the veterinary community.
One of our partners is led by a true industry pioneer. Terry Jones is the founder of Travelocity, the co-founder of Kayak, and is now once again setting out to transform travel with his newest venture, Wayblazer. Please join me in welcoming Terry to the stage.
Thank you. Good morning. As you can see from my gray beard, I've been going down the road of business for a long time, both in tech and in travel. I started my career as a receptionist in a travel agency over 40 years ago. And back then, high tech was a little different. I actually made my first reservation by telegram. That was high tech back then. And then I worked for 20 years at American Airlines and Sabre as CIO, where we put together fares and schedules and automated over 40 airlines. And then we took that power and distributed it to travel agents and revolutionized travel because now you could call one place to get fares and schedules. And then we did it again with Travelocity, which was really the first self-service travel site. And then we changed travel again with Kayak by revolutionizing search and mobile. Now, back when we started Travelocity, information was only flowing one way. But pretty soon, users began to create their own information. And information became a two-way street as user-created content came about. Buyers still shared experiences, but no longer one-to-one over the backyard fence. Now, one-to-many over the network. On sites like TripAdvisor, where they have over 100 million hotel reviews. 80% of Americans won't even make a hotel reservation anymore without first reading a review. So we've had this explosion of travel data creation. Facebook, Pinterest, YouTube. What kind of data is there from users? It's a lot of it data about travel. So 90% of the world's data created in the last 2 years, 80% of that data is unstructured. That's a problem. And much of it is dark data, digital exhaust, data that was forgotten, never accessed. So my favorite airline has the information. I generally sit in seat 4B, but they don't know it. They don't do anything about it. My favorite hotel has the information that I always want a high floor room, but they don't know it. They don't use it. So we have issues. Traditional computing is having a hard time dealing with these increasing amounts of unstructured data. Traditional computing is unsuited for its analysis. Enter cognitive computing. Enter Watson. So you've heard from Mike all the amazing things that Watson can do. How does this apply to travel? Well, first of all, let's remember, travel is the sherbet between courses of reality. Travel should be fun, and travel can be fun. But is travel planning fun? Yeah, online booking is awesome. But remember, it's not a 21st century product. Travelocity, Expedia, Orbitz, Priceline were invented in the 20th century. And 20th century travel planning is still difficult. The average consumer searches over 20 sites in order to plan their trip because something's missing. And what's missing is expert advice. The web doesn't give advice. Today, travel advice comes from books, it comes from articles, magazines, it certainly comes from TripAdvisor and reviews, it comes from Facebook. But the number one source of travel advice remains our friends. That's been unchanged for a very long time. Because online, everything has to fit in the box, from, to, where, when, number of stars. And search only gives you clues. Do you realize if you search for best hotel in Hawaii, you get 58 million answers? That's not advice. That's a clue. So how could cognitive computing change this scene? How could it make it better? Well, let me give you some scenarios that we're showing to various travel suppliers today. I need to be in New York by 3 p.m. for the meeting on my calendar. Stay at the Hyatt near my meeting, and could you suggest a place for dinner? Yes. One click, it's done. With Watson, you can have an excellent assistant. What about what airlines call off-schedule operations? You call them delays, a little bit different. And you're standing there and you're on the phone and the system is saying, your flight has been canceled, I don't understand, you can rebook for Dallas tomorrow. What are you saying? Agent, 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 agent. Not because the system doesn't understand your voice, because it doesn't understand what to do. So how about the ability to say, hey, forget about London, I can't go there anymore. I have to be in Paris tomorrow at 8. Where it understands Paris, tomorrow, and 8, and simply gives you the answer. There's a big change. How about you're in flight and you're coming into LA, and the system says, hey, here's some duty-free items. But instead of a list, it says you might not know it's 50 degrees at night in LA in October. How about a scarf? That's a different kind of commerce. So why can't discovering my perfect trip be as easy as a conversation? So you know what's possible, make magic out of it. A simple answer to a difficult question. I'd like to go to a 4-star international beach resort in January with my wife and kids. Needs to have a great spa, kids' activities, and a good restaurant. You can make that entry into your favorite search engine, and you'd get something. But you wouldn't really get advice. I'm determined to fix that. How? By taking structured data, social data, Twitter data, Glide data, blog data, article data, demographic data, past trip data, location data, weather data, deals data, and giving it to Watson with its unparalleled natural language processing and ability to structure unstructured data. And we're using a cognitive graph database as well to create a totally new product that understands natural language, offers advice with confidence levels, 82% chance you'll like this because we've already done all the work for you, gives you insider insights, and then commerce from those insights. So that's Wayblazer. Let's drill down on it for a second. First is cognitive search. So our first customer is the Austin Visitors Bureau. I'm heading to Austin for a guy's trip with three buddies this fall. Put that into a search engine, you'll get trip and fall, a lawyer. Put that into Wayblazer, you'll get go to the Formula One Grand Prix, go to Austin City Limits, go to a UT football game. That's what guys do in Austin. Then cognitive insights. Yes, I'll tell you everything about the Formula One Grand Prix because I've searched social and blogs and guidebooks. But I also can tell you, sit on turn 15, that's where the most fan action is. Take Burleson Road to avoid the traffic. It's not going to rain. We can give you insights on the fly as well. As you land, we can tell you, hey, this afternoon it's going to rain. Why don't you go to the spa? Here's some more insights. Austin's known for food trucks. Are there any food trucks in Austin? Sure, let's take a look at Torchy's Tacos. Ask for the secret insider menu that no one knows about. Or, I want to hear some music. Yeah, you can go to Emo's, but there are only two bleachers in the back. You might not want to take your wife there in high heels. Using Watson to tease out these amazing insights and to save you some time. Leading to cognitive commerce, So I'm going to recommend that you stay at the Austin Omni Hotel, not only because it's a great hotel, but also because Foursquare tells us all the fans stay there. Commerce like you've never seen it before. Our markets are cities, states, hotels, airlines, car rental, cruise, magazines. What are we going to do for them? Improve visitor experience, improve search, improve advertising, improve commerce. So, Wayblazer, cognitive search, cognitive insights, cognitive commerce. That's a new kind of product. We think that Wayblazer, powered by Watson, is a game changer, a really different kind of product. And if you think about Watson itself, its ability to make sense of unstructured data, to offer advice, to speak a natural language, and to learn, that's a game changer as well. A system that can do all that can really change the future of business. So what can you and Watson do together? How are you going to apply Watson to change your business? To be successful, you need to be in, you need to be quick, and you need to be bold. And maybe, just maybe, you can use Watson to revolutionize your industry. Thank you very much.
Thanks, Terry. What a great story. So, what does it take to equip a cognitive ecosystem? We've been focused on three things. First, it's all about APIs. We started with one simple service, question and answer, in January. Last month, we expanded that to 8 services, scaling to dozens more over the coming months. Second, content. We've introduced a Watson content store to help provide the information developers need to jumpstart their cognitive application. Third, skills. This one is fundamental. We've launched an ambitious educational initiative in partnership with universities the stature of Stanford, Berkeley, Carnegie Mellon, Northwestern, New York University, The Ohio State University, RPI, University of Michigan, UT Austin, and the University of Toronto, all teaching tomorrow's innovators how to build applications that run with Watson. And the classes started this fall, not next year, this fall. By next year, the number of schools participating in the program will be over 100 globally. So let's put this in perspective of how partners and organizations alike are adopting Watson. Wayblazer, as you just heard, is reinventing the business of travel with Watson APIs. Other organizations are using these same services, now available on IBM Bluemix, to build cognitive enterprise applications. We announced Watson on Bluemix 3 weeks ago, and already there's been 1,500 developers, 2,200 apps under development in the pipeline, and they've already made over 1 million API calls into Watson. Enterprises are beginning to ramp up their cognitive capabilities with foundational products like Watson Analytics that you saw demonstrated yesterday, a new generation analytics solutions based on natural language capability, opening up the ability to learn and visualize new insights in order to reach a much broader group of professionals. Watson Explorer, the new version builds on the best-in-class exploration and analytics capabilities across unstructured and structured information, offering an organization a 360-degree view into their information so that they can make better decisions. It also provides enterprises with the ability to bridge cloud-based Watson services and content with on-premise properties and proprietary data, creating an ideal framework for getting started with Watson. In every Watson engagement we've done this year, we've learned that locating and managing information is one of the first critical steps, namely the need to curate content for Watson. The question comes up, when do you update the information? How do you manage the information lifecycle so the right information is always available to Watson, all the while keeping a clean audit trail for corporate governance? So we've announced IBM Watson Curator, helping professionals locate and and lifecycle management for that information. Organizations are using our repeatable advisor solutions to expand the way they think about engagement and employ totally new approaches for spurring innovation in their organizations. ANZ Bank and USAA, for instance, are using Watson Engagement Advisor to redefine their customer experience. Today, we're announcing Watson Engagement Advisor version 2.0, now with cognitive conversational services to make interactions with Watson seem even more natural and nuanced. But what if you don't know the right question to ask? Industries and professions are on the hook to find the next big breakthrough, from pharmaceuticals to industrial products, from chemists to researchers. Organizations like those I referenced earlier, Johnson & Johnson, Baylor University, and Santa Fe, are putting Watson Discovery Advisor to work. Apps. With the Watson app portfolio I mentioned earlier, you get Watson for specific use cases, like Watson for oncology, or Watson for wealth management, or Chef Watson, plus many more to come. We're also integrating Watson services into the IBM portfolio of products that will be identified as powered by IBM Watson. The first three are IBM Kinexa's HR solutions, IBM i2 for intelligence discovery, which you saw in the demonstration earlier, and IBM Connections. As you can see, we've made a tremendous amount of progress as we bring Watson to market. It's hard to believe that it was less than 10 months ago that we announced the Watson Group. Let's take a brief look back.
This is the formation of something called the IBM Watson Group.
It's going to help us see the world in new ways. It's going to help us unlock possibilities. We built a technology called Watson Engagement Advisor to explore how they take their data, put it in Watson, and allow people to ask questions.
It's not about what the technology does. It's about what it does for us. Watson is the ultimate collaborator in the creative process.
The Discovery Advisor. It's to discover the relationships between things that you really have never seen before. The partnerships, Memorial Sloan Kettering, MD Anderson, Mayo Clinic, financial services companies, telco companies.
Our best and brightest work with our partners, with our clients, to help create the future. Together, we're going to change the world.
We're moving into a world where perpetual discovery and instant access to expertise is going to enable every citizen to become a scientist, every institution an innovator. We're entering an era like one we've never seen before. Every question is going to become a dialogue, every interaction a learned experience, and every action or decision will be well informed. We're going to enhance, scale, and accelerate human expertise. To learn more about the work we're doing, we hope you'll join us at the Watson and Cognitive Computing keynote that follows this session down the hall. You can also experience Watson firsthand in the Solution Expo. I look forward to hearing how you'll put Watson to work when you come visit the Watson Experience Center at our new headquarters at 51 Astor Place in Silicon Alley, New York City. And let me assure you, we are just getting started. Thank you.
Man, thank you, Mike, and everyone who presented. I think it's so amazing to see all of the ways that Watson could be applied across all these different fields. I mean, it's gone way beyond just playing Jeopardy to now fighting cancer, finding meth dealers, and even whipping up a three-course meal. I don't think Ken Jennings can do that. It's really impressive stuff. And we're going to continue our story now with another moment of insight. where we're going to hear a real story about how big data and analytics is transforming not just a company, but also an entire industry. And I'm joined here by the CIO of Vodafone India, Anthony Thomas. Thanks for being here, Tony. Now, Tony, Vodafone India is the second largest mobile network provider in all of India. So what kind of challenges do you guys face?
We are the second largest telecom operator in India with about a little over 170 million subscribers. Wow. And we are probably one of the largest, if not the largest, multinational operating in India. And as you know, India is a very complex country as it is. The telecom environment in India has been predominantly a prepaid environment. So where people buy the prepaid cards and then use it on a daily basis with an average spend of about $3 per month. So which means about 10 cents is what they spend on a daily basis. And they actually buy this on a daily basis. Now, in the voice world, they exactly knew what they were buying. When I'm spending 10 cents, I know exactly how many minutes that I'm getting. Sure. But in the data world, it's very difficult to really figure out how much data am I consuming. When I watch a video, when I browse YouTube, when I use WhatsApp, how do I do it? So people actually started getting concerned about what kind of spend am I having. People cannot correlate the money with the kilobytes that they spent and the amount that they were browsing. So it's become a big problem for us.
So you almost get that bill shock when you watch all of season six of Sons of Anarchy on your phone and then realize it cost you $5,000.
Pretty much.
Right on. So how do you guys deal with that problem?
What we tried doing was to take the shock out of the bill.
Nice.
So what do we do? First and foremost, we had to keep our customers informed upfront that, hey, you are consuming this much data. You are about 50% of your utilization, 80% of your utilization, et cetera. But then what we started also giving them was canned offers. So off-peak hours, you could use certain, maybe watch YouTube so that it's much cheaper for you. And then, you know, in some cases, we even moved them from prepaid to postpaid. So there were quite a few things that we did. But I think foremost is to us to keep them informed about what they were doing and how they were doing that.
That's great. So you're using the data to actually inform your customers and help them make better decisions.
Exactly.
Great. So what kind of results are you seeing from that?
It's been very positive. We have a very good data uptick. So the consumption of data has gone up quite well. Our number of calls that comes into our call center complaining about bills, our usage has come down drastically. But our customers are very happy. Probably most importantly, the Net Promoter Score, or the NPS as we measure, we are head and shoulders still above our competitors out there in the market. So as we say in Vodafone, happy to help.
That's fantastic. So not only are your customers happy with you, they're probably very happy themselves thanks to your big data solution. That's great. You couldn't ask for more. Thank you so much, Tony. Give it up for Tony Thomas.
Thank you, Josh.
Thanks, buddy. Appreciate it. Man. And if you guys bring that to America, I'll switch to Vodafone. I need that. So we've been talking a lot this week, and we'll be talking more about all the ways that we can use big data, huge amounts of data, to gain insights. And like we said, it's a very exciting time to be in technology. But I can't help but be reminded of a quote that I heard recently from my friend Kim Rees at Periscopic, who said, in just a few short years, the term big data is going to seem quaint. How cute that we thought we had big data. And what she was referring to was the Internet of Things, the exponentially greater amount of data that we're going to start creating as we start instrumenting our thermostats, our cars, even our bodies themselves. I recently saw a sensor that you can swallow that sits in your belly and transmits your vitals to your doctor. That's happening now. And think about all the data that that's going to create beyond just the business case, but also in the ways that it's going to change our lives and could be used for good. So I know it can be hard to think about the Internet of Things because it seems abstract, but there are a couple of new things that are really exciting to me that I think make it much more personal. One thing I'm excited about is Water Canary. It's a little sensor that you can actually put in a water stream, and it measures the contaminants and sends it up to the cloud in real time. And there are also parallels to this for air quality, little things called Birdie, which measure how good the air is in your house. And as Mike was just saying, if you imagine those sensors being deployed everywhere, now we all get to be scientists. We all get to be ecologists measuring that kind of information. And we talk a lot about the cloud, but let's talk about what's happening in our skies. When you hear the term drone, you might think of the military, but increasingly, unmanned aerial vehicles are becoming ubiquitous and are being used in a huge range of applications. They're already predicting they're going to be the most popular gift this holiday season, And I've already seen cases where they're being used to thwart natural disasters, hunt down kidnappers, and prevent poaching. So imagine a world in which we're going to have those flying sensors everywhere. It's going to be crazy. And then lastly, a topic that's very near and dear to my heart and to IBM as well, is the fact that our cities are becoming instrumented. They're virtually becoming nervous systems of information, whether it be sensors on our roads that are detecting traffic conditions, or mobile phones that can actually detect where there are potholes. I recently just saw a group called Blue City, which is putting sensors in garbage cans to measure how much garbage is filling up over time so that they can understand what people are throwing away, when, and cities can be more efficient in how they're getting rid of waste management. And all of this, of course, is just the tip of the iceberg. There's going to be so much more coming down the line, and it's going to need so many new tools and technologies to make sense of all of this data. As Jeff said on the first day, the Internet of Things is going to wake up and start babbling at us. And when it does, only those of us who are speaking data are actually going to be able to take part in that conversation. So let's revel now in these quaint days of big data, because the world that the Internet of Things is going to show us is going to be much, much, much bigger. For more on how the Internet of Things is dramatically changing our businesses and our lives, please join me in welcoming General Manager, Information Systems, Beth Smith.
Good morning. So let me tell you, that walk on stage, you know, it may seem easy, but for some, it is actually nearly impossible. 15 years ago, my husband lost a leg. Since then, his prosthetic has helped him get around, but he has had to change the way that he lives to fit that device. How he walks, how he climbs stairs, how he gets in and out of cars. It really limits the activities he can participate in. But a few weeks ago, he received an entirely new type of device. It's a leg that has a computer in the knee joint. The sensors in the knee hold his body measurements and can flex and bend the knee to help correct his gait. And the result is he has the right amount of movement to now be able to walk really easily. No longer does he have to adapt to the device. Now, the device fits the way he wants to walk. A whole range of activities open up for him that simply weren't possible before. Looking back, who would have thought that an artificial leg would have sensors, technology, sophistication? Certainly in my world, I have personally witnessed sensors changing lives. You know, I'm actually amazed by the level of innovation that's unfolding in medical devices. At IBM, we're working with a startup called Bionic Labs. They've developed an incredible exoskeleton to help disabled patients. It's loaded with sensors at every joint and every point of movement. And Bionic Labs plans to use our services on BlueMix to analyze data from their exoskeletons while the data is collected in real time. This then can be coupled with the data from the rehab doctor so that now all the data will be accessible to hospitals and investigators during their clinical trials. This enables adjustment in treatment that in turn will yield much better patient results. And of course, that's really the ultimate goal. New kinds of data from machines and devices combined with existing information can be analyzed and shared to generate better outcomes. And it is this that is at the heart of the Internet of Things. The Internet of Things is about the instrumentation of everything. Just look around you. People, machines, everyday objects, and nearly everything around us. Our world is digitized and interconnected, and it gives us an incredible source of data. And because of that, we see an explosion of applications that use the Internet of Things. Our clients are creating new, innovative, data-driven products and services because of that. I want to share some examples. Let's start with Peugeot. They happen to be here this week telling their story, which I'm sure many of you would like to hear in person. And they've enabled their vehicles with connected services. Now, what this does is help drivers avoid danger zones, help them find parking locations, and help them find less expensive fuel. But in addition to that, they're also creating products and services with their partners, like, for example, fleet operators and insurers. All of this built on the new data that is gathered from their vehicles. Daidu River Hydropower, which is a Chinese utility, they combine weather data with existing statistical models and satellite images. And their goal is to then more effectively forecast energy generation in a part of China where the weather is particularly unpredictable. And then there are solutions that bring data about people, things, organizations together to create value in context, in real time. The Internet of Things is about something much better than bigger than instrumentation. The data generated from local events is becoming connected with other information, such as enterprise data, public data, social media data, and many other sources of data that we have. Integrating all of this and making sense of it leads to a world where the Internet of Things becomes the Internet of Insight. After all, it is insight generated and applied across many applications that is actually transforming industries. We see this in three simple steps. It starts with capture, the ability to secure the data streaming from devices and gateways, followed by analyze, which is the ability to develop new insights based on the integration of information from devices, enterprise systems, and other both public and private data sources. And finally, act. The ability to initiate new processes and actions to deliver business outcomes where they matter. At speed, in real time, at massive scale. In yesterday's opening video, we showed the endless possibilities of how connected cars will change transportation. Let's dive into a part of that system and the needs of how to react very quickly. We're working with car manufacturers, insurers, device makers, and other stakeholders to help improve the safety in vehicles. So back to the steps. What can we capture? Data from sensors in the steering wheels, video cameras in the cars, even data from sensor-connected clothing. And of course, there's the mobile phone, which everybody already has in their car. Now that data is captured, it needs to be analyzed. And in the world of car safety, there is very little room for latency. So data must be rapidly integrated from these devices and sources to correctly diagnose a relevant event. Analysis determines the difference between a driver who might be falling asleep from someone who might be suffering a much more serious health situation. And finally, a decision must be made to take the appropriate action. If the driver's fallen asleep, the car could wake him with a vibration, audio signals and flashing lights, or completely take control and automatically park the car. In a more serious emergency, the vehicle could slow itself down, pull to the side of the road. Emergency services could be called automatically while the sensors on the driver's clothing are assessing his condition. Other details, such as health records, could then be connected through the cloud to alert a nearby hospital of the incoming patient's current status. The ability to instrument a single driver through his car, clothing, and phone could be realized in thousands of connected cars. and therefore inform how emergency services are deployed, how insurance models are offered and priced, how health care is administered, how city transportation services are set up. In this very simple example, we saw how the connected car improved vehicle safety and reshaped some related services. The ability to capture, analyze, and act on the Internet of Things will truly transform industries. So how do we enable all of this? Starts with BlueMix. BlueMix is an open standards, cloud-based platform for building, managing, and running applications. On BlueMix, we have essential services needed to be able to create insight-driven IoT applications, an IoT foundational service, a JSON database service from Cloudant, a time series service, and a number of other related services, all valuable for IoT applications. So, let's put some of these services to work and build an application. To help me out, please welcome Vice President of WebSphere Foundation, Michael Curry. You know, Michael, they built the desk too tall, so I'm going to get up here so that I'm finally at your height.
Yeah, I like that. That's good. You're still a little shorter, though, to be honest. So I want to get into a demonstration of kind of the concepts you just talked about, and I think there's some really interesting things that we can show here. So I'm going to show how easy it is to build a simple demo around your phone, actually, and I brought it up here for you.
Okay, good.
So we'll build it around your phone. And what we're going to do is we're going to show how that a sensor can actually sense your phone and help keep you safe from a piece of equipment that you're not really trained to be around in an industrial scenario. So in the process, we're also going to show you how we collect data from this environment, and then we can use that and analyze it to improve safety in our facility. So we're going to use some of the new capabilities that INHI announced yesterday.
Good.
For this. So first of all, there's three new capabilities in BlueMix that we're going to be highlighting. First, we're going to use Cloudant, right? And that's going to be our tool for actually acquiring the high volume of, you know, real-time data. And that's really the capture piece you spoke about before. The next piece, then, is really to use DashDB. And we're going to use that to perform all the analytics on the data that's coming from the sensors. And there, we're going to show visualization around that. And that's really the analyze piece. And then the third piece is I'm going to actually build the rules and the logic that are going to keep you safe in an unauthorized user scenario so that you stay away from that piece of equipment. I'm going to use Node-RED for that, which is part of our IoT foundation service in BlueMix.
Okay.
So we'll pull those three together. That'll be the ACT portion, and I'll show you how it all fits together. So let's get started. So before we get started, we do need a piece of equipment. Now, it just so happens that I brought a piece of equipment, something that could work on the plane.
Okay.
And here it is. I rolled it out. So.
Wow, that went under the seat?
Yeah, it doesn't fit very well under the seat. And, you know, TSA gets a little worked up about it. I think I might ship it next year instead of. Okay. But
good idea.
Anyway, so that's our piece of equipment. And you can see it's got skulls on it, so it's clearly dangerous. And to do this, I'm going to actually go into BlueMix and log into my environment. So let's get started. Of course, I have to log in. And I'll sign in. So I've already created an application in BlueMix using our IoT Foundation boilerplate. So that should come up here. I don't care about my free trial. Okay. And this application actually was just created. All I did was just click on Create an App. And you can see that we have a set of boilerplates. One of the boilerplates is the Internet of Things Foundation Starter. And what that does is it allows me to connect physical devices into the cloud so I can begin collecting information from them and talking to them remotely and things like that. But I already created the app, so we'll go back to my dashboard and show that. So what we need to do here is actually build a scenario where that is talking to you and it can sense how close you are to it. So the way that's going to work is this mobile phone is actually going to be receiving a signal from a little white disc that sits on the front of that box. I don't know if you saw it before.
Okay.
That's an iBeacon. Okay, and that iBeacon is transmitting Bluetooth data. And as you get closer to it, your phone's going to pick that up. This phone is then going to connect into BlueMix, send the data up to BlueMix, and then I'm going to build some logic about what we're going to do about that. And I want to check to see if you're authorized to be near it and all that.
Okay.
So we'll go ahead and build that application. In order to do that, I'm actually going to be using the IoT Foundation service and a tool called Node-RED, which is in there. Node-RED allows me to visually wire together logic around the Internet of Things using JavaScript nodes. So I've sort of pre-built a lot of these nodes at the bottom. It's kind of like a cooking show. Yep. You know, we have some things before and after, just to kind of save time here. But the basic flow here is simple. I'm going to receive a proximity alert from the phone, the app on the phone, as soon as you get close to that. Based on that, I'm actually going to create a query. And that, what I'm doing here is I'm actually going to look at look up in the cloud and database to see if you are authorized. So it's our system of record here to know whether you're authorized for this. And based on that, I'll make a decision, you know, are you authorized or are you not authorized? And if you're not authorized, then I'm going to take one of three actions. I'm either going to I'm going to alert you, and we'll just send you a little alert on your phone so that you know you're in a danger zone. I'm also going to actually send a shutdown command to the machine itself. So we'll shut that thing down so that you know you don't actually get injured. So I got to wire those things in. And then I'm also going to log this information in our cloud and database so that later on we can analyze who did this horrible thing and why did it happen. And then, you know, if you were authorized, we'd just go ahead and pass it through. But in this case, you're not going to be authorized because that's kind of make it more fun.
Yep.
So I'll go ahead and deploy this. Now, when I hit deploy, this is actually deploying everything I need in the cloud in real time. And it all, you know, is all running in active code. So you need to take this phone.
Okay.
Go approach that dangerous piece of equipment over there, and we'll see what happens.
Okay, I guess I went too far.
That's good.
It's going to save me from that.
It did exactly what it was supposed to do.
Good. So the funny thing is, we didn't know what it was supposed to do.
Now we do. Okay, so good.
So that was really helpful. And seriously, though, when we think about something like this, you know, a machine shutting down can be quite expensive. So can anything be learned in that same episode to prevent the machine shutdown?
Yeah, absolutely. It's a great point. And, you know, part of this was you saw that I was collecting information in the cloud and database here. Mm-hmm. So I'm actually gathering information about every time somebody gets too close to a piece of equipment. And what you don't see in this is that I'm actually synchronizing that data to DashDB so that when every time something happens, I synchronize it over and I can do some analytics against it. So let's take a look at some of those analytics.
Okay, good.
And I actually built a little script here that I can run to show some information about the data that we gathered. Okay, and of course it logged me out, so give me a second. So this little script, all it's doing is just basically running to, you know, creating two charts, but it'll take a second to log back in. All right, so go into that, and then I'll run those scripts. Live demo, guys, live demo. All right, so now we ran that. So now the first chart here is actually showing me all the people that have gotten too close to equipment over the last 2 years. And wouldn't you know it, look who's our worst offender. It's Beth. You seem to have a problem with a dangerous piece of equipment.
You know, that's really interesting. I'm shocked by that. Could it have anything to do with my training, though? I don't think I'm doing anything wrong.
That's a good point. Actually, the second chart that I generated could tell us something. So I could take a look at this, and this will tell us who the supervisor was when these events occurred.
Well, look there. It appears that Bob was the supervisor when all of these things occurred. So maybe the issue isn't really me, but instead the need for greater safety training for Bob's team.
Well, you know what? I'm going to let you tell Bob that, actually.
Okay. I'll take care of that. So it seems that you've really identified this training issue, and now we have the opportunity also to cross-reference that with my records and see if maybe Bob should do a refresher course for himself and the team around workplace safety.
Yep, sounds perfect.
And we'll just leave in Vegas the fact that that was Bob.
Excellent.
So, seriously, based on this information, you know, I could apply streaming and predictive analytics to these real-time events to trigger an alert before the safety violation occurs, thus keeping the employees safer and saving money at the same time. I like it. Thanks, Michael.
Thanks. Take care.
Okay. The Internet of Things is about analytics, combining new kinds of instrumented data with existing information at speed and scale, and generating new insights and outcomes. Now let's hear from one of our clients who is putting IoT applications to use in the real world, maximizing customer engagement in shopping malls. Jake, over to you.
All right. Thank you so much, Beth and Michael. That was an awesome demo of Bluemix. And based on a little impromptu data collection, based on how many people were holding up their cell phones to take pictures, you guys thought it was pretty awesome, too. I'm joined here by the CEO of Hildebrand Technologies, Josh Cooper from London. Josh, thanks for joining us.
Thanks, Jake.
And why don't you tell us a little bit about what we're seeing on the screen back here?
Well, this is a day in the life of our sensor networks, which are deployed in retail locations all over the UK. And we're collecting about 1 billion data points a day.
A billion?
A billion.
Wow.
Big numbers.
Yep. That's crazy. So as an IBM partner, I'm sure you have to process a lot of that real-time data. So what are you using to get your insights?
So what we're doing is we're processing the data through machine learning. And then we're taking that data and we're putting it into some of the Bluemix tools and some of the cloud platforms that IBM is hosting for us. So you can see that we're getting some insight out of the paths that people are taking to come in and out of the shopping centers. And that kind of helps our customers optimize what they're selling in these shopping malls and when they're selling.
That's great. So who's using that info and what kind of insights are they getting from this?
Well, at the moment, we've got mostly the shopping center owners that are using the data, and then the retailers who are looking at the kind of micro trends. And we've got another application, which I think we've targeted an ad to everybody here. We've done the segmentation correctly. And we have APIs that hook into digital signage.
Right on. So you can tell if somebody is a techie, gambler, or mature based on the patterns of data they give off?
Which is this crowd, right?
There you go. I don't know if they're mutually exclusive, at least for me, but that is really fantastic. So how can people learn more about this?
So what we're doing is we're offering one of our devices so you can get your hands on it. So if you go and follow us on Twitter, then you can kind of, you know, we'll send you a device. You can hook that into Bluemix. Or if you just want to use it at one of your retail locations or your office or your home, you can do that.
There you go. So you guys can sign up and actually try one of these out. Go try that out. Check out hildebrand.co.uk. And you guys can have lunch with Josh to learn more about this at the Internet of Things industry lunch tomorrow. So please go check that out. Josh, thank you so much for being here. Give it up for Josh Cooper.
Cheers. Thanks.
And of course, we talk a lot about analytics on top of data, et cetera, but often we don't talk as much about infrastructure and the fact that now we can use big data and analytics to make smarter, better infrastructure so that all of our companies can grow and prosper. Please join me in welcoming Vice President, Systems and Technologies Group, Doug Balog.
So good morning, everybody. It's great to be here today. You know, I think you can clearly agree we are in a new era of IT, a new era, an era where we're drowning in data and yet still thirsty for business insights, an era where we're so desperate to connect together the mobile interactions and the social sentiment that is occurring in the Internet of Things with the sensors you saw Beth out here demonstrating. And still speed is killing us, right? Speed to connect together those new applications, not only with the systems of engagement, but the systems of record where that final version of the truth exists. So the question I ask you, the question you're probably all pondering, does infrastructure still matter in this new era? Well, I'll tell you what, let's see from a few clients what they think on this topic.
People are always trying to save money, so we have to be very competitive on how we price our product. We needed this software to, A, save us money. It also needed to perform well. It needed to be easy to use, and it needed to be reliable. As I started running some jobs that normally take 30 to 36 hours to run, and it ran in 2 hours the very first time I tested it on DB210. at the end of the day, it allowed us to do more work throughout the plant on a day-to-day basis. So anytime we speed up transactions, it's a win for us.
So about 10 years ago, we started working with IBM in terms of a new solution, a new way to solve a problem for the National Football League. And instantly, we were able to create more and better schedules using IBM software and hardware. So the insights into what actually goes into the quality aspect of a schedule has been a night and day gain for the National Football League over the last 10 years. We are considering factors that go into our schedule that we didn't even used to think about, we didn't even know about. Now they're part of the data that helps us determine where to search in that search tree.
Not all data is created equal, nor is it formatted in the same way. So having an infrastructure that can handle these things allows you to mash up different data sources. And for that, Power combined with Big Insights provided a good solution for us. We could take structured data, unstructured data. We could take data from different repositories, put it together, and start to extract information from that. IBM allowed us to really leverage this platform and go into places where companies haven't gone before.
So whether it be the clients in the video or the thousands of clients around the world that we interact with every day, the sentiment is the same. The sentiment that infrastructure actually matters more today than it ever did before. Now, we're not just taking a few clients' word for this. We actually went out and did a business value study, an Institute for Business Value study. We talked to 750 CTOs, CIOs, CEOs around the world, perhaps some of you. And we asked them this exact question. Does infrastructure matter? A couple pieces of insight that came out of that survey. First, over 70% of the respondents said absolutely yes. Absolutely yes, infrastructure matters. Interesting, though, only 10%, self-scoring, said that they believed they were positioned with the right infrastructure. Less than 10%. A third very interesting analysis that came out of that was, of that 10%, call it sort of a small group of really thought leaders, their business performed over three times better than the rest of their competitors because of having the right infrastructure. So the survey says, as we know, infrastructure absolutely matters. Let's sort of peel through some of these client examples here just a little bit deeper. North Carolina State, as you saw in the video, over 30,000 students in my home state of North Carolina, as well as 2,000 professors. They are teaching and working with their students in the business school to really put together business insights from the data of structured and unstructured data. They chose IBM Power Systems with an open stack of software with Linux running IBM Big Insights for Hadoop. With that, they saw the analytic queries that sometimes never completed actually running from days into hours, a 37 times improvement. They also saw a 4x shrinkage of their data center, less capacity, less heating, less staff to run the infrastructure based on IBM Power Systems efficiency. If you jump to the far side, we heard from Coca-Cola as well. It's all about supply chain optimization, getting the right product in the right stores, at the right place, at the right time, with the right price. Insights from their tremendous troves of data is critical to their operations. And trust me, we know supply chain. They saw a 20x improvement in addition to the efficiency they saw, a 20x improvement in their supply chain optimization. And finally, Swiss Mobilar wasn't in the video. Swiss Mobilar, an insurance company and pension company, obviously in Switzerland. Their goal was to bring together islands of data to create a better client experience. They wanted to bring in new clients and treat their clients to an experience where they could see across those islands with a single view, whether it be the systems of record, the traditional data they had, or the new data being generated through a mobile social front end. They picked a System Z, a mainframe, to integrate those islands of data together for a single view and a better experience. So some great examples of how clients around the world are taking advantage of big data, but focused on the infrastructure to deliver a superb business outcome. Now, yesterday you saw, I believe, from Bob Picciano, the way in which data is changing the world, the way in which data is driving innovation, as well as new business models. Well, I'd like to say here, and you know, unfortunately, we've all been in Vegas many, many times this year. Imagine being in Vegas without infrastructure. Where would we be? We'd be sitting in the middle of the desert right now having a nice little intimate conversation around a cactus. So infrastructure absolutely matters, whether you're in Vegas whether you're talking about your IT environment. But it's also about creating differentiation. Differentiation for each of your businesses in a very unique way. So not one answer is the only answer you should have. So what are we doing at IBM in our infrastructure business to provide you with that capability? First off, when it comes to big data needs big systems that run and crunch the analytic algorithms. Those algorithms need to span across multiple cores, multiple processors, multiple threads. That's why our power systems have phenomenal horsepower to run this capability. By the way, they also run IBM Watson. As Mike and the team talked about earlier today, the capabilities and challenges Watson puts on infrastructure are profound. And IBM Power Systems were chosen. We didn't make Watson run on power. They chose the right system for that kind of new cognitive era. So lots of cores, lots of processing, lots of compute. In addition, memory needs space. It needs cache. It's close to the processor. It needs very fast access to memory and a large memory pool. Imagine, ladies and gentlemen, a 40-terabyte memory space. 40 terabytes. I think we'd agree that's big data in action. And it's got to be able to move the data around. We all know data is not stagnant. It's not stale. It needs to be in motion. It wants to be in motion. You want it to be in motion. That's what our systems can do. At the same time, our system Z, or Z if you're from Europe, is about integrating those pieces together, integrating the real-time analytics that can come from not moving the data off and spending all the time to move the data around your enterprise, but by bringing it together and integrating it on the same footprint. And finally, it's about the storage. I think we can all agree it's not just about storing the data. It's about providing fast access to information, fast, intelligent access to information. That's where our flash storage comes in, that fast access to information that you need at the right point in time. So it is about data in the right place at the right time. Infrastructure absolutely matters. Now, we've talked here throughout the last couple of days about systems of record, kind of that final version of the truth, systems of engagement, those mobile social applications that are creating new types of data, and at the center point of this is systems of insight. Now, some of this is delivered in the cloud, both public and private, and certainly it needs to be focused around security. That's why not one tool is the right tool for each one of these jobs. It's about having systems and storage that can address each of these needs in the way they want to be addressed. Imagine a carpenter showing up to your house with a sledgehammer, and that was the only tool they had. Imagine going to a retail outfit where they only sold one suit in one size. We provide a choice of the infrastructure to fit your needs so that you can get the best insight and have the agility and flexibility within your infrastructure. Let's talk about another client example, TBV. TBV is about a 50-year-old company. TBV, please. TBV is about a 50-year-old company over in Hong Kong. They were one of the early providers of wireless broadcasting. To no surprise, they saw themselves under attack from the internet and streaming of shows. They came to IBM to ask for help. What they were looking for was how did they get insights from the ratings, the data they had for nearly 50 years, but also the mobile sentiment about the shows, looking, as in the NFL example you saw in the video, for new insights about how to schedule and take that information to their advertisers. That's what they were able to do. They took the traditional data they had, the ratings, the new mobile sentiment data, and they brought together new insights that they never would have seen before to create new business models to bring to their advertisers and get a successful return to their business with new advertising dollars and new profit streams. A strong success in Hong Kong. All right, let me start to wrap up. At the beginning of this brief moment here together, I ask you a question: does infrastructure matter? And hopefully you can see, and as we've talked, there are examples of how we are creating truly differentiated capability in our infrastructure, optimizing things like DB2 Blue on power to deliver an 82 times benefit in analytics. The hundreds of thousands of trained IBMers that can work with you every day to help you get business insights, our number one position, which we take very seriously in terms of our analytics, our flash, our software-defined storage, and our server business. It's about Watson. You heard Mike and the fact that Watson fully leverages this capability of Linux on power. And it's about our mainframe platform, 50 years young and many, many more years to go, with new innovation that brings together analytics and transaction processing with the highest security in the marketplace. So I'm hopeful that I've enticed you enough to want to come spend some time with us this afternoon. Yes, we have a keynote session at 3 o'clock. I hope you'll join me, where you can hear us explore even deeper this notion of infrastructure mattering in this new era. Joining me will be analysts, clients, and business partners, where we go even deeper into this topic and hopefully entice you with understanding the IBM portfolio and the advantages we can bring to you and your businesses. Thank you very much, and I look forward to seeing you this afternoon.
Thank you so much, Doug, and thank you to all of our keynote presenters this morning. Give it up for everybody who spoke this morning, everything we saw. Wasn't that awesome? It felt like sci-fi to me. It was crazy. So keep that energy up, because today is just beginning, and I want to remind you that everything we're doing today culminates, of course, in tonight's main event, Rocktoberfest, where we're going to be joined by award-winning band No Doubt. The 16-year-old boy in me could not be happier about that. It's going to be awesome, so that's going to be right back here at 7 p.m., so join us for food, drinks, and a ton of fun. And of course, we're going to be back here again at 8 a.m. tomorrow morning for our final general session, Charting Your Journey. And you guys aren't going to want to miss that, because we have two incredible speakers coming. We have Captain Phillips, the real Captain Phillips, not Tom Hanks, as many have assumed. We're having Captain Phillips come to tell us a great story, but if you still want to hear from a celebrity, we're also having two-time Academy Award winner Kevin Spacey coming to speak and talk about the role that analytics played in House of Cards. That is going to be awesome, so please don't miss that. And as you go out today, if you haven't had a chance to volunteer with Stop Hunger Now, there's still time. It only takes 30 minutes in the expo to feed someone for 2 months. And of course, as I and my company Datakind are always talking about data for good, I'm very pleased to remind you all about the Big Data for Social Good Challenge that is happening with IBM and Hadoop. So IBM is partnering with cities like Los Angeles, Boston, and San Jose to provide a platform, tools, and problems so that developers can compete to create real solutions to social good challenges. It's going to be a really awesome event. I hope that you'll all donate your skills there. And get this, for every app submitted, they're going to plant a tree. So you don't even have to do a good job to give back. So the coding for that starts on November 10th. Of course, you will all do a good job. And you can look at ibmhadoop.challengepost.com for more on that. So with that, I want to thank you all for another fantastic morning. Have a great day as you go out there, and we'll see you back here tonight for No Doubt. Thank you.
You can't read your customer.